And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the CEO of the Churchill Club, Karen Tucker.
Hi, everybody. Welcome. I'm Karen Tucker, CEO at the Churchill Club, and this is a very special occasion as we welcome author Barry Eisler, former bookstore owner Clark Kepler, on-demand printer Dane Neller, publisher Steve Piersanti, and our favorite moderator, author Guy Kawasaki. Sorry for having my back to you here. They're going to lend their latest insights into trends, strategies, and opportunities around the future of publishing. We wish to thank Citrix Systems for hosting us in their wonderful state-of-the-art facility. Please join me in thanking Citrix Systems. A note that this program is being videotaped. It will appear on the Churchill Club YouTube channel within 48 hours or so, so feel free to pass the word along. And it is also being live streamed on a Google Plus Hangout. A brief introduction for our new guests in the audience. Churchill Club is the top independent forum for business and technology discussions in the Bay Area, now in our 28th year. We are fairly obsessed with encouraging innovation, economic growth, and societal benefit. We do this through the up to 40 programs that we present each year, where like minds can learn and connect with one another. And this is our final program of 2012. In January, on the 16th of January next year, we reconvene with an illuminating conversation called Will Tech Power the Next Jobs Boom? With a rockstar panel of economists. And this will be held in San Francisco, and we hope you will join us. If you are tweeting, please use the hashtag Churchill Club, and you will find other Twitter codes in your printed program. My last announcement, if you are considering joining or renewing your Churchill Club membership, now is an excellent time to do so. Attendees of tonight's program may join for just $99, which is a savings of $26. Visit the registration table for information on how to sign up and other specials that are available to you. And we are a 501c3 not-for-profit organization, and your membership is tax deductible. Let me now introduce Guy Kawasaki, who will cause the rest of the panel to introduce themselves. Guy is very well known as the former chief evangelist at Apple, as well as the co-founder of Alltop.com, Garage Technologies, and many other fruitful pursuits, such as authoring or co-authoring 12 books. 12 books?
12.
Last year, the publisher of one of Guy's recent books called Enchantment could not fill an order for 500 ebook copies. Because of this experience, he decided to publish his next book called What Plus. And what he learned firsthand is that self-publishing is complex, confusing, and idiosyncratic at best. And this inspired his next and latest book called Ape, Author, Publisher, Entrepreneur, How to Publish a Book. The book's purpose is to help people understand what Guy calls artisanal publishing and to help writers control the publishing process and produce high-quality books with results that rival traditional publishing. Please welcome Guy Kawasaki.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Carol. I'd first of all like to thank Betty Taylor of Krauss Taylor, because this panel was her idea. So without Betty Taylor, there would be arguably no panel. So thank you, Betty. Betty's sitting right over there. As a moderator, I like to let each individual panelist introduce themselves. This is because I've been a panelist many times, and I can't tell you, I think it's probably 50% of the time I get introduced by the moderator blows my introduction and gets it wrong. So rather than having to be careful, I thought I would just let them introduce themselves. That way, if they blow it, it's their fault. It's not my fault. So I'll start here with Barry. Barry, go ahead.
Hi, everyone. My name is Barry Eisler. I write fiction full-time, mostly a series of thrillers about a half-Japanese, half-American assassin named John Rain, whose specialty is making it look like natural causes. It's based loosely on the exploits of Guy Kawasaki.
Very loosely.
I've had a few interesting jobs along the way. I spent a few years in a covert position in the CIA, and then I was a technology lawyer and a startup executive here in the Valley and in Japan. And writing full-time is the best job by far I've ever had. I really love it. I love the new world of publishing we're in. I was talking to someone a little earlier this evening, and a fellow named Bob, who asked me what my angle is on publishing, and I said, I got to think about that. I really should have an angle, shouldn't I? And then I realized I do, and my angle is just this. I think that anything that makes books more accessible, more widely available to more people is good, and I support it and salute it. And anything that makes books less accessible, more subject to control by central entities, I tend to be uncomfortable with. So that's more or less where I'm coming from in the way I look at the new world of publishing. Overall, I think it's amazingly exciting. It has more choices for authors, offers more choices for readers than ever before, and I think it's a great thing. Hopefully we'll talk a little bit about that tonight.
All right, thank you. The next speaker is Clark Kepler. Clark is the founder of one of the best bookstores in the world, frankly. It's Kepler's in Menlo Park, and I want you to know that 2 days ago I spent about $150 there buying printed books. So, and I also checked your nonfiction business section, and my books are there. So, because I was going to give you a load of crap if there weren't. Maybe you just put them out there for the day because you knew I was coming.
Well, you better stop there, Guy, because you've already blown my introduction twice.
Oh, sorry. Okay. So this is Clark Kepler.
Hi, I am Clark Kepler, and I'm the son of the founder.
Oh, I'm sorry. See? I rest my case.
My dad started the bookstore, Kepler's Books, in Menlo Park in 1955, and I have been ran the business for 32 years or so. Having retired this year, passed the business on to a new team and really exciting things that they're doing there. So I'll tell them that the book is missing from.
Well, it was also spying out. I would prefer cover up.
Absolutely. But you know, in my time in bookselling, it's really been a tremendous opportunity to be a part of the distribution chain, and you know the philosophy that Dad started the bookstore with was to provide ideas and information to our community and to provide as much variety in the process, to have a broad inventory, and engaging with our publishers' reps to help us in the book selection, and engaging with our community has really been the way that we crafted an inventory that is what our readers told us they wanted. So we touch the end user every day in bookselling, and it's really one of the areas that interests me the most in sort of the discussion we're having in terms of what's happening in the future of publishing. And my measurement oftentimes is what's the end user's experience ultimately going to be, because we're all just here to sort of be a part of providing it, and it's the reader's experience that I think is the most important. So I'm interested in seeing where the future takes us, and concerned that the reader's experience is enhanced, both in terms of the quantity, but also the quality of what they're able to have access to. In a democracy, we need a lot of information, a lot of input. And today, the way we can access information and exclude ourselves from the opinions of those that we don't agree with is a concern for me in terms of what we do to really inform ourselves, and are we excluding and trading separate camps in our lives? And I think that publishing and bookselling is right in the middle of that conversation, and I'm hopeful that we'll emerge from it with more diversity and more opportunities rather than fewer.
All right. So, Dane, I'm just gonna like talk about general platitudes about you because I don't want to get anything wrong. Dane has a company called the Espresso Book Machine that produces an espresso book machine, which is a very interesting idea, and it could truly mean that nothing will ever go out of print, right? I mean, that's one of the consequences. So, Dane.
So I'm the founder with my co-founder, Jason Epstein, who was the one of the major publishers of the 20th century at Random House. of the company called On Demand Books, which makes the espresso book machine technology. Prior to that, I was the owner of a company called Dean & DeLuca, and so my background was really retailing. Don't blame me for high prices anymore, Dean & DeLuca. And so my partner and I, Jason, who was the publisher, came together and felt that there was a need to find a way to breathe life into retail bookstores and libraries and other establishments. And we created this technology that could make a book at point of sale within 3 or 4 minutes. It's a physical book, looks just identical to a book you would buy at a bookstore. And our vision is that over time, content will go direct to consumer or direct to retailer. And that's what we're seeing now. You're seeing it right now with ebooks, and you're going to begin to see it more and more with print on demand, and that the supply chain will get disintermediated. So our business model and our vision is that, and we're actually very optimistic about the future of self-publishing or what we call user-generated content, because we think as the cost of distribution decreases, the author will have in their power much more power to control the sales channel and the distribution of content. And that the retailer, you're seeing this with Amazon, and soon you're going to see it more and more with bookstores and mass market retailers, will become a partner with the author in selling their content. So that's what I do. And we'll have a lively conversation around that.
I will tell you that towards the end of writing Ape, I sent a Microsoft Word manuscript, and the first page was just a JPEG of the cover. And I sent it to Dane for him to read. And he turned it around and printed it and sent it back to me. And I was amazed. I mean, I didn't have any planning. There was no sort of special codes in Word or anything. I just sent you the Word document I was using. It came back very, very nice. So I'm a believer.
Thank you.
Steve?
I'm Steve Piersanti. I got started in book publishing in 1977 as an advertising copywriter, subsequently became a marketing director and then an editor, and president of Josie Bass Publishers in San Francisco, which was a prominent independent house then. I left Josie Bass in 1991, soon after it had been acquired by Robert Maxwell and had become part of the Maxwell Communication Media Empire. And I founded Berrett-Koehler Publishers in 1992, which is where I still am. Berrett-Koehler is one of the more successful independent book publishers in the country. We have a mission of creating a world that works for all. So we're a mission-driven publisher, which makes us a little unusual as a publisher. And we believe that in order to create a world that works for all, we need change at the individual level, at the organizational level, and at the societal level. So we have three publishing agendas. One is about individual change. Another is about business and leadership, organizational change. And the third is about societal change. We publish about 30 to 40 books a year. I still work as an editor. Besides, our company tries to practice a lot of the ideas in our books. So we do a lot of partnering with authors. We have something called the Barrett-Koehler Authors Cooperative, which is, we don't know any other publishing company that has something like this, where authors have banded together to support each other, that we've given it our blessing. We try and avoid a class system in our company. We try and do a lot of the very progressive things that our books talk about and how we run our company in a more partnering way.
All right, thank you. So I am going to, the format of this is I'm going to ask them basically the same question and they'll each answer it from their perspective so that you can get different slants on the publishing industry. But before I do that, how many of you are Barry Eisler readers already and know the John Raine series? Okay, so I have to ask you, so how many of you know who Lee Child is with the Jack Reacher series? Okay, so I have to ask you a question. So as a mystery and thriller writer that you are, what do you think of Tom Cruise playing Jack Reacher? Can you wrap your mind? It's like Ashton Kutcher, Steve Jobs, Tom Cruise, Jack Reacher. I can't get my mind around that.
Do you read the Reacher books?
I love the Reacher books.
They're great books. If
for anyone who doesn't know, Lee writes a serious character named Jack Reacher, who's about 6'5", 250 pounds.
Right.
And that's really one of the distinguishing characteristics of the character. And Tom Cruise, his company bought the rights, he was going to produce, and then over time he decided he wanted to play Reacher. And it was, and the movie is going to come out, I think, any day now.
Friday,
yeah.
Yeah.
So it's a controversial move on his part, especially among hardcore Lee Child fans. And you know, I'll tell you, since you, to me it's a very interesting question. I personally don't have a problem with it. it's not how, I could go on about it, I'm going to make this quick. Tom Cruise said something pretty smart, I thought. He said, look, Reacher's size is a characteristic, it's not the character. And I think that's a nice soundbite, nice because there's some truth to it, unlike many soundbites out there. So to me, you know when Daniel Craig was cast as James Bond, did you know how much controversy there was over the fact that he's blonde? Now, personally, I don't think that blonde hair is the heart of that character. I think that's a variable that you could change without affecting the essence of the character. The size of Reacher, I think, is not as easy a call, but I think it's doable. If you made Reacher stupid or a bad detective or not adept with violence, yeah, you would you'd be violating the heart of the character. Changing his size, for me, it's not really a problem, but a lot of people are concerned about it. Lee's happy about it, I'm sure, because all this controversy is going to lead a lot more people to see the movie and discover his book, so I'm sure he has no problem.
So if you had your pick of anybody, who would play John Rain?
Oh, okay. that was a soft.
Suppose
ball.
I was busy. I mean,
I don't know. You know, names that come up. Keanu Reeves is an obvious choice because he's half Caucasian, half Asian, and there aren't that many actors who fit the bill. But I think Johnny Depp could play half Asian easily. John Cusack easily. Joseph Gordon-Levitt, I think, is a terrific actor. And that guy looks half Japanese. Every time I look at him, I can't believe he's not. So,
What if you sold the rights and, you know, George Takei played him?
Well, I love George Takei, but he's a little old to play.
Okay. But, you know, age isn't his character. But,
it's an interesting question.
Okay. So I just have to get that off my chest because, not often I sit next to the author of one of my favorite series. I only read mystery and thrillers. So, you know.
Well, let's hope we find out.
This is a great moment for me. So, so the general question for all of you, from your perspective, just describe where we are today in publishing. From an author, bookstore, you know, vendor, and publisher, where are we? Because I think this is a question, if you ask five different people, you get, you know, seven different answers on where the publishing business is. So what's your analysis of where the publishing business is? Starting with you, Barry, as the author.
I think the way to understand publishing is this. Publishing has always been primarily about distribution. And until recently, the only way to distribute a book was paper. It's neither good nor bad, it was just the state of the art of the technology. So for authors, if you wanted to reach a mass audience, you could theoretically go to Kinko's, have the book printed out, load up the station wagon, and drive around the country, but it would be hard to reach a mass audience in a cost-effective manner that way. So what this meant is that you needed primarily a distribution partner. That means, typically, traditionally, a New York publisher. New York publishers have added a lot of value-added services onto distribution. They don't just do distribution. Obviously, they do things editorial, marketing, they package the book, they design covers. We know all this. But fundamentally, what New York publishing has always been built on, its fundamental value add, has always been distribution. This is the thing you can't get for yourself. I can get my books edited. I can market my books in a variety of ways. I can hire someone to design a cover. I can write my own jacket copy. In fact, I always have. But the one thing that in a paper world an author could not do cost effectively without a big distribution partner was paper. Without a big partner was paper distribution. So the theory was the publisher would say, we will be your paper distribution partner, we will take 85% of the proceeds and you will take 15%. And you will make it up on volume. This is the theory of legacy publishing. And it's not a bad theory, it's not a ripoff. I mean, J.K. Rowling is a cash billionaire and she was built on that theory. I mean, she's probably getting more than 15% at this point, but that's how it started. So you can make it up on, James Patterson made $94 million this year. Legacy World. Again, special case, he's probably getting more than 15%, but still, the theory is you'll make it up on volume. It's a good theory. What has completely upended this universe is the advent of digital distribution. Because in a digital world, a lone author can distribute his or her books 100% as effectively alone as with a gigantic conglomerate operating out of New York with a multi-billion dollar parent company like Bertelsmann or News Corporation or whoever. So it takes a minute to get your mind around that. I'm just talking about distribution for the moment, not marketing or any of the other value-added services that New York has attached to its fundamental value-added service of distribution. As a self-published author, I can distribute 100% as effectively alone as I can with a gigantic partner. And what that means is if a gigantic potential partner comes to me and says, hey, Barry, we would like to distribute your book electronically. We'll take 85% of the profits and you'll make it up on volume. That's like somebody trying to sell me air. I don't need it. It's ubiquitous. I have air. You have to sell me something else if you want me to pay for it. So the question for me, a very interesting question, and we're starting to see what I think is this question being answered now. What is publishing going to be built on? What is new publishing going to be built on, given that authors do not need a distribution partner in a digital world any longer? And I think the answer is direct-to-consumer marketing. What authors still can't do, and maybe never, and I don't think ever will be able to do, is effectively themselves, in general, there's always going to be exceptions, as well alone as they can with a big partner, is direct-to-consumer marketing. So Amazon is very nicely positioned in the direct-to-consumer marketing world. You know why, we don't even need to belabor the point. But if I'm right that new publishing is going to be built primarily on direct-to-consumer marketing rather than on distribution, then what we can do is we can start asking, well, what other players are well-suited to adapt to this and take advantage of this new world? And I started getting this idea, by the way, a little over a year ago when I read that the Los Angeles Times was publishing its first book. And I thought, that's weird. I mean, I wouldn't have thought of that. Why is the LA Times publishing? And like that light bulb went on over my head, and I said, of course, it's digital. They don't need distribution. They don't need trucks. They don't need warehouses. They don't need boxes of books. And what they have is eyeballs. They've got their own website. And they've got their own, I don't know how many papers they sell these days, but they can certainly advertise direct to consumers on their own website very cost effectively. And what they're in a position to do, therefore, is to say to an author whose book is right for their audience, we will publish your book and give you some percentage. Well, we'll keep a percentage. I don't know what it's going to be, 50-50, 65-35, I don't know. But the idea is we'll keep a good percentage of this, because you're going to make it up on volume, because we're going to reach so many readers for you. I think it's an excellent theory. It was proved in the paper world, and now it's being proven again in the digital world. That's where I see publishing going, on the non-self-publishing front, but on the overall like big publishing front.
Okay, Clark, from a bookstore perspective.
Yeah, interesting as you described the sort of macro change from a very sort of micro perspective of booksellers. What we're seeing in this transition is a loss of some of the intimacies of relationships with the publisher's representatives. Historically, the salesperson from a publishing house that would come and meet with our buyers and essentially present the entire list, open the catalog, and go through it, there's a really sophisticated relationship that has existed between the buyer and the sales rep in which really good sales reps knew the reading community of that bookstore, you know, very well, and knew what their editors had had informed them about these books. So the editors, you know, fully inform the sales team about the quality of the books and what sales market it would operate in, and that would be translated to the buyers who are making this decision about a trusted relationship with a salesperson, and translating that into what they buy and don't buy for the bookstore, what's going to end up on the shelf. Any major list that comes in with 1,000 titles, they're cherry-picked. Those titles, many of them aren't ending up on a bookstore shelves, and I know you've got some statistics that prove that out, Steve. But the nature of the change that now it's up to a author to essentially get their brand out there and end up in a bookstore, certainly the independent market is a different animal than what the model you're describing here. I think Barry probably only had to be convinced, my buyers only had to be convinced once that Barry's books could sell. After that, it was just there's a new Barry Eisler and you buy it. And the top echelon of writers that represents the 1% that there anybody that makes any kind of money as a living writer is probably in that 1% percentile. The rest of the people that are writing are need to be really good marketers now, really good at self-branding in many of the ways that Barry's described, or they're going to just languish in, you know, the little books that are self-published and sitting in their friends' homes. So this is a change. My concern still remains that, you know, what about the really brilliant writers that are not very good marketers and aren't extroverted presenters that can get their brand out there? There once was a time where you could actually read a manuscript in a publishing house and say, this work is brilliant, and publish it, and you've got a classic piece of literature that lives on for decades. That may be changing in this model, and I think that's something that maybe ought to be tried to consider it in the process. If we're going to think about what kind of, you know, what this new model looks like, hopefully there's a way to still allow the non-best-selling author an opportunity to really get themselves out there. So I you can tell, you know, I've got my foot in two camps, sort of, and my experience going back was a lot of how things have been. And I'm concerned about the changes for those reasons. I think the examples and the entrepreneurial spirit that is described going forward is exciting, no doubt about it. But there's a win-lose in that if we're not mindful of how we do it.
Okay. So, Dane, you have a very interesting background because you have this retail background.
Right. So
you're bringing in this digital technology.
So I agree with Barry. I think so. Amazon view of the book business is, let's sell other stuff and we'll use books to sell that other stuff. That's fundamentally what Amazon is doing with books. And at the end of the day, it's not a bad thing because they're very consumer focused and they're bringing down the cost of content. That's okay because the cost of distribution is going down. But what's going to happen in my vision of what I'm seeing on the marketplace is you're going to begin to see Walmart, Target, CVS, and independent bookstores, you're going to begin to see them getting heavily into both self-published content, user-generated content, printed content, and ebooks in a big way. And it's the author who can market directly to that retailer is going to be successful. At the end of the day, what's not readable won't get sold. That is. But many more authors will have a voice. And there probably are a few Shakespeare's out there and some Twain's and some, and then there's a lot of bad stuff. And that stuff will get, that's kind of the Amway model of self-publishing. Sell it to your mother and your brother and your wife and your sister. And actually, that's okay. That's good for the author solutions of the world. But good material will be read. How you market it through your retailers will make a big difference. But I agree, Barry, it is going direct to consumer or direct to retailer. And it's a worldwide phenomenon.
Okay. Steve, I'd love to hear your analysis of Barry's analysis of the value of traditional publishing in the past, pushing paper, and it going forward in the future now.
Okay, well, I'm going to start out by saying that my answer to your question, the original question, is on every table there's a handout called the 10 Awful Truths About Book Publishing, which is on your table. So that's been I've been updating this since 2004, and the unfortunate
started
thing
started as only two of
them. Yeah, yeah. Well, it keeps getting worse and worse every year. Every year I update it. Every year it's worse. And basically, what's been happening is that book sales in the United States peaked in 2007, and they've remained flat or gone down since 2007. Meanwhile, the numbers of books being published has exploded in the last 5 to 10 years. And so there are the marketplace has been glutted. The marketplace is saturated. The marketplace is oversaturated. The average new book in the United States today that comes out is only selling about 3,000 copies over its lifetime. Among university presses, many of the books that are being published are only selling 600 to 800 copies over their lifetime. That's across all publishers. That's across Random House and Wiley and, you know, all the publishers put together. It's very small numbers in relation to the numbers that are being published today. So that's the big picture of what's going on. Now, what I tell authors in what do you do about this? How do you respond to that kind of environment when the marketplace has just become saturated with books? The first thing I tell authors is give up the idea that anyone is going to ever actually read your book. Because I have to admit, I'm talking here about the nonfiction in this part of the analysis. I don't know fiction. Fiction's a different story. But with nonfiction, the way the game is played today is that most people, they try and get the message of the book without actually reading the book. You try and figure out the message of the book or what to get out of the book from what you heard about the book, from what somebody told you about the book.
You're killing me, man. You're
the
killing
title.
Me.
I'm not. and you might read a few pages, but the way the game is played is you go hear the author speak. It's exciting. You get the book is almost a memento. And so you have to craft the message so that you get it without, if you have to go to all the trouble reading the whole book, forget it. The book is not going to sell, it's not going to work. You have to be very clear. The second thing I tell authors is give up the idea that anyone is ever going to actually buy your book. Because most of the sales today in the nonfiction marketplace are not individuals buying the books themselves. Most of the sales in the nonfiction marketplace are what we call pass-along sales. They are somebody is buying the book and then giving it out. It's a CEO buying it for all the department heads. It's a department head buying it for the team leaders. It's a coach buying it for the people she coaches. It's a consultant buying it for the people in the change program. It's a trainer using it in a training program. It's classroom use. So most of the sales are pass-along. Therefore, what we are doing as a publisher and what we're coaching authors to do is you really have to reach out to the pass-alongers as the people are going to be selling your book. Now to the question of what the publisher offers, the publisher still has a role in many ways in terms of being a coach to the author, being helping the author to make the book a much better book, a book that's going to reach the marketplace better. The publisher has a role, as Barry was saying, in creating channels to reach the marketplace. Most of the actual marketing, what the publisher does is sets up the channels, sets up the ability to reach into the marketplace. Most of the actual marketing today is done by authors. They're the ones who are driving most of the sales, but the publisher set up the channels to drive the sales through. And that's all over the world, not just in the United States. But I could go on with that later. But there are various roles of being a curator, of helping ensure the quality, the editing. There are lots of roles, but you're right. The role of the publisher is less than it used to be.
Are you therefore taking a less percentage because the marketing is falling upon the author?
No, and actually the only way that publishers are staying afloat today is the publishers have pushed much of the marketing cost onto authors. This is across the whole industry. It's when we get a book proposal from any agent anywhere in the United States, the proposal always has 5 to 10 pages about what the author is going to do to market the book. That's mandatory. You know, every proposal you get from any smart author, from any good agent, always has the 5 to 10 pages of what the author is going to do. And what that has done, it's become so much harder to make books sell that the only way publishers have stayed afloat is by pushing the cost structure, externalizing the cost to the authors. If they hadn't done that, most publishers would be long since out of business.
But this is the problem. Publishers are supply chain managers in an era where you don't need that anymore. And if publishers used to, they do two things very well. They're Verlagers, they're banks. Lots of authors go to publishers because they get advances. That's a big thing. Two, they used to be great curators and filterers and they provided a very strong editorial function. And I'm not saying you don't, but many of the big six publishers don't do that anymore. Right. So what are they? They're warehouses, they're trucks, they're supply chain managers. What do you need that for now? You don't. And unless, and if they don't give it up, the author's going to take over their own fate. And I think you're going to see more and more of that. And I think a lot, I think the publishing world is in danger of being disintermediated.
I would like to ask now for Barry to give advice to Clark. And then, so I want each of you to advise another person on the panel. So an author telling a bookstore how to survive, you know, espresso book machine telling a publisher how to survive. Publisher, you know, just go back and forth. I want to hear, like, if you were colleagues and friends, and
well, we are.
How would we help? How would you help the other person? So Barry, you could start off. Pick any of the three and say, you know, this is how I, well, this is what I would do if I were you.
So Clark, if I'm addressing you as you are a bookstore owner, then I think the opportunity for brick and mortar bookstore owners is to work directly with authors. And probably in conjunction with a terrific machine like the espresso book machine. it's the
printing
printing
ape.
And it, exactly, printing a great book ape, which by the way, I really did read. I read three, you know, maybe I'm the exception to the rule. I read three of Guy's books. I've learned a lot from them, including ape. But anyway, I don't know nonfiction that well, but. Yeah, in fact, a couple of writer friends of mine, Joe Conrath and Blake Crouch, wrote a blog post at least a year ago, probably more, practically begging independent bookstores to partner with them, cut out the middleman, that would be publishers in this case, and they said, we'll sell you our books and we'll just go, I don't even remember what the percentage split was going to be, but for convenience, let's say it's 50-50. They would supply the books and then they just become direct partners. And I know that's not necessarily good news for the middleman publisher, it's not, I get that, but what you have is if there's a certain amount of money you can make from any commodity, let's say a book, and if you have a lot, think of it as a pie, and a lot of people are eating from that pie, it means the portions that are available to everybody who's eating are going to be smaller. If you push somebody away from the table, it may be ruthless and cold, but still there will be more pie for the people sitting at the table. And so this was Joe's and Blake's insight, and they said, so we want to work directly with you. And these guys are name authors. They're well known, not the hugest New York like Lee Child or Nora Roberts, but they're name authors. And I thought it was an amazing idea. And I still think it's an amazing idea, but nobody contacted them. So I think that kind of partnership, direct partnership between brick and mortar stores and authors should be huge. And especially with a machine that dramatically reduces the cost of, well, there is no real distribution cost. I mean, the machine itself, I guess. But you're no longer putting boxes of paper books together and shipping them to warehouses and putting them on trucks and all that kind of stuff. So the espresso machine is great because it lowers the cost of distribution. By the way, I'm totally agnostic on digital and paper. I just want people to read. I care so much more that people read than I do about how they read. I don't care if people read on stone tablets, if they can be distributed cost effectively. Probably not. But I want, if you want to read the way you want to read, I want to find a way to provide that way to read for you because you like it. Then more people will read. So I think paper's terrific. It's venerable, obviously. It's great. It doesn't break, and I love paper books, actually. I actually like paper books a little more than digital. Not many people know that about. People assume I'm some maniac for digital. Given a choice, I like a good paper book. But I don't really care. I certainly don't care how you read. I love the espresso machine because it reduces the cost of paper books, and I think that's great. It means more people have access to books because the cost is lower.
Do you want to work in our advertising
department? Clark, you get to advise somebody. Like
yeah.
Maybe a publisher.
But, you know, so if I talk to Steve, because I think what you do at your publishing house is so different from the norm of publishers out there that it's, you know, I would almost say I think those publishers need to look at the model that you have and try to do some replication there, that the relationships with the authors are the, you know, the essence of what publishing is all about, and you know, I agree with you, Barry, that you know, what's important is that people are reading, and I think we find ourselves in the network chain, oftentimes, you know, lamenting some aspect, and if we keep our eyes on what we, you know, wherever we end up with this, we want to be able to have people having more access to more quality information, books, literature, and I think that the publishers must recreate themselves today as every aspect of the chain must, or it's going to get pushed away from the table. The ability to have a model like that and to replicate it. Perhaps I'd personally recommend if there's ways to share that your mission-based efforts and get more publishers sort of looking at that model and not forgetting that their relationship is with the author. What they certainly don't have is relationships with the readers. And I think that's one of the things that is putting publishers at risk is they don't know who reads their books, and people that read their books don't know their brands, really. I mean, people know the name Random House, but if you ask what's the last book you read, who published it, it's an unusual thing to know which publisher, and it's certainly unusual to have a brand loyalty to a publishing house as a reader, a consumer of the book, the way you might have a brand loyalty to your electronic device or other mediums. So,
So Clark, before I forget, you alluded to Kepler's having a new model. What is the new model?
One of the things that I think is clear is that the traditional model of book selling, especially for independents, is pretty much broken. That the profit margins during the best of times was 2% profit margin was really healthy. As we see expenses happening and discounting, all that impact sales generally stagnant or declining. The sort of ongoing joke in the industry is that flat is the new up. The expenses that bookstore like Kepler's has had for years is this added value of an author event series, bringing speakers in, going out into schools and other organizations, bringing authors, a lot of coordinated effort, promoting it, bringing in an audience, offering free events, and selling 8 books sometimes. Even when you sell 100 books, which would be a great event, you look at how much cost went into it, and the result is really that this is sort of just a marketing initiative. And so the new model is essentially taking the business and bifurcating it, taking the bookstore and keeping it a for-profit entity, and taking the events and the marketing, the give-back programs, the variety of things that Kepler's does with the community, and creating a not-for-profit entity there that can be funded by, we've got a community that has put their money up for Kepler's on 2 occasions in the last 7 years to keep the entity going, and only now is it going to be possible for that to be a tax-deductible contribution and something that it restructures the costs by taking the marketing and the occupancy costs and putting it into this other entity. So I think it's a really good blueprint. It's yet to be proven out, but I think it will prove out, and I think it's something that can be replicated in other communities where there are other independent bookstores that have similar types of challenges. And one of the things that Kepler's Books has experienced since the 90s when I started talking to colleagues about this thing, Amazon, that is starting to sell so many books, and my customers love it so much, and booksellers around the country would go, "Don't worry, it's nothing. It's just a flash in the pan." And then 18 months later, they'd go, "Yeah, this thing Amazon is really getting to us." So we're obviously in a community here that is very receptive to the next new thing, and I think we need to be. I think this new entity will respond to that. The difference is that the meat of the bookstore experience now is not to try to compete with Amazon on Amazon's terms, but to create an experience that can't be replicated online, to bring authors and readers together. The experience of the bookstore itself is what people crave, and the community experience, the face-to-face conversations.
Okay. Dane? Advise somebody.
This is more of a commentary than a piece of advice, but I actually think the bookstore, retail bookstore business is in a renaissance. And everyone is talking about the demise of it, but I don't see it that way. What I see is the demise of the big box bookstore. I think I would not want to be in Barnes & Noble shoes right now. But I think the independent bookstores have that ability to do just what you were saying, Clark, to engage with their community, to engage with the author, and to become, bookstores used to be publishers. That's how they started. And they're going to go back to doing that more and more. So I think there's an incredible model out there for kind of a Starbucks on steroids, where you have a Starbucks meeting bookstore. A Kepler. And people like to go to bookstores. Just you go there, they like to hang out. You cannot get that browsing experience on Amazon. You do not get it. Amazon can all the time say, if you buy this, you might like this. It doesn't work. What works for publishers and why bookstores are so important, people browse. They go in, they look. They'll go to the section on European history and then find a book that they want there and there. And they go around and they'll have a cup of coffee, and that's 80% gross margin, and that helps subsidize the rest of the book business. Sorry. But that is, I really believe that is there. It's a good avenue to be in. I have a question, though, for an author. If Walmart or CVS or Target came to you guys and said, I want to work with you on your books, how would you advise an author on how to work with a mass market bricks and mortar retailer? It's kind of a...
I'm not sure if you're looking for the nuts and bolts, but again, to me, it's about eliminating the middleman and going and forming a direct partnership. I'm surprised Barnes & Noble has not done this yet, because it would make perfect sense. If Barnes & Noble publishes the book, then, and the author, and by eliminating the middleman, it could be any bookstore, it could be a small independent bookstore, which I agree with you actually makes in many ways more sense, but leave that aside for the moment. So if it's a giant retailer, this is what I would say. Here's what we'll do. We're going to be partners. I don't know what the split is going to be. We can argue about that and negotiate it. But what I do know is that the publisher is not going to be there to take, say, 55% of what's available anymore, whatever that number was going to be. So there's a lot more for both of us. And what that means is, I get more for each book sold, and that means I'm more motivated to help you sell the books, to use whatever kind of marketing capability, online or in-store visits or whatever, I can do to help you move books. And you are now motivated to sell my books relative to all those other books, because your profit margin per unit of all those other legacy published books is lower. There's a great play here for any giant retailer. I don't know why, why are they not doing it? I don't know, because they're hidebound.
They're going to.
But they do it on a print-on-demand basis? Because otherwise, there is risk from the retailer in terms of the unsold books.
They're going to do it more on a just-in-time print model. Mm-hmm. I would say for the nonfiction market, there's an unbelievable opportunity to tie the author of a piece of nonfiction to what mass-market retailers sell. That's what Amazon does. So if you happen to be an author of a cookbook or gardening tools or power tools or whatever, there's an unbelievable opportunity to have a direct kind of one-to-one marketing relationship with a retailer and be able to combine that book into what that bricks and mortar retailer sells. That's and in fiction, there's probably a corollary to that, but that is the Amazon model. I see the bricks and mortar retailers doing that now. It's kind of weird that it took Amazon to get them to do it, but that's what they're going to do, and they're going to turn their stores into warehouses. The minute that Amazon lost its ability to kind of save on taxes, they start to move the warehouses closer to the consumer. That sounds like retailing to me.
So are you saying I would go to Orchard Supply, I would buy some kind of toolkit, and then I would use an espresso book machine to print off how to fix my patio?
Well, I think that an espresso book machine would work well with a mass market retailer. Say you're at Walmart or Target.
Yeah.
And there's a classic example, because they have small footprint bookstores. So they're only going to sell the front list, and they're going to have a very thin offering.
Right.
But that doesn't mean they can't sell an enormous offering of backlist titles, because all you need is a digital file and you can print the book. But I think you'll see a lot more tie-in. So if you happen to be a cookbook writer and you get some following, I could see Walmart saying, hey, come in and buy this cookbook and get that cooking pot. I think there'll be a lot more of that tie-in.
Cookbooks are a good example, but when you start getting into things like, I don't know, a history of World War I or something like that, I don't know.
Oh, that's a but that's a classic, mm-hmm. because that's affinity. When you when a retailer understands what that person likes to read, mm-hmm. I mean, if you're reading a, if, chances are, if you're reading a book about divorce, you're going to be buying furniture. Or if you're if you love French history, there's a good chance you're going to like red wine. I mean, this is what Bezos does. This is his model. And when I said he's given up on the book business, he hasn't given up. The book business is a loss leader for him. I doubt he makes any money in the book business. That's why the publishers have to get with it, because Amazon is eating the publisher's lunch. In fact, they're publishing now. My point here is that I do think there's a wonderful opportunity for authors of all sorts to take it. I think it empowers an author. It's just what you're saying. I think there's a tremendous opportunity for self-publishing right now, and to use direct marketing with retailers to sell books. Again, if it's not readable, it won't be read. But anyway.
Okay. Steve, advice for anybody else on the panel? Okay,
well, I'll offer advice to Barry. Speaking as an author in general, not just for you personally, but because once again, I'm coming more from the nonfiction area, but some of this would be true for fiction also. When you have a crowded marketplace, when you have a glutted marketplace, what stands out are brands. People turn to brands when things get very saturated, and so the more that an author can build a brand, the more you're going to be able to succeed in this glutted marketplace. That's point number one. Point number two is the nature of how people are buying books is the threshold for deciding to buy a book has gone way up. If you go back 5 years, 10 years ago, and you heard about a book that was of interest to you on Good Morning America, or you saw a little review in the Wall Street Journal or something, you might go ahead and go out and buy the book. But what's happened now is that everybody has stacks this high of books on their credenza that they haven't read, and their reading habits have changed, and they're getting most of their information over the internet now. And so you just don't go out and buy the book in the nonfiction like you used to. And so in order to get over that threshold, what does it take to get someone to buy a book? One answer is the pass along, as I was saying. So you cultivate people that pass alongs. Another answer is your community tells you to buy it. When your community says you're part of a reading group, or your family, or you know, whatever is your community. And so authors, the more that authors can cultivate communities, the more they can build a community, the more likely they are to have success in selling their books. And then the other thing is that is selling books now is what we call immersion experiences. And once again, it's a matter of the threshold. You're not going to buy a book just because you've heard the author be interviewed for 3 minutes on a show. But if you've gone to an event where the author's speaking and you've heard the author speak for an hour, then you've got more invested. You're over that threshold. And then you go ahead and buy the book. And so speaking
of... It'd be a shame if this turned out not to be true tonight, people. Don't make Steve wrong.
So it's
called the detachment.
Yeah, right? Then the book almost becomes, again, a memento. Of you've invested an hour in hearing the author speak, you want the memento. And so the speaking has become more important than ever, which then pulls back to one of the areas for the independent bookstores is they host many of the author speaking events, and they can host a lot more than they're doing now. That's an enormous growth area for that sort of thing. And so again, that's another area to really focus.
How does someone pass along an ebook?
That's actually more difficult at this time. And so most of the pass along that's being done is being done
paper.
By paper, but we are struggling with that ourselves right now to set up. So I'm going to ask David Marsh, who's our VP of editorial and digital. I'm going to throw that hard question at him.
Yeah, I was just going to say that right now, a lot of our authors who do speaking engagements and conferences, instead of just having the books in the back of the room, they'll get download codes of 100, 200 of our PDFs, and then they'll distribute the PDFs right with the registration materials for the actual conference. And so what we're seeing a lot more is for all the events that they used to use books on now, they'll come in, either the conference leaders or the authors themselves, they'll buy 50, 100, 200 conference access codes at a time, the access codes will get distributed. Or someone doing workshops and seminars for companies, they'll just download the access codes and distribute them. So it is happening. The pass along is happening through the access codes.
And this access code, let's say you get 100 access codes. It's limited so that only 100 downloads can occur, or it's 100 different access codes for 100 different people?
In our case, different publishers do it different ways, but it'll be 100 different access codes. And so you get the access code, and then you download it, and you own that access code for the duration. And because we're doing it in PDF, that means you can distribute it to all the different devices, so that it's not just stuck on a Kindle or just stuck on an iPad. It's available to you and owned by the person who got the access code.
And you're not worried that you're going to do this one time and every PDF will be on BitTorrent?
Well, there's different ways to do it. Some publishers actually do the Adobe editions and other ways to protect on the front end. We use companies like Attributor to protect on the back end by doing takedown notices. And we notice it's just the best sellers that get stolen, not any of the other ones. And if your book is getting stolen, that's a good sign that you're selling a lot of books, because that's the only thing that people are stealing it.
So please steal my book.
I mentioned my friend Joe Conrath. He writes under J.A. Conrath. He wrote a blog post, and I should mention this, if anybody's interested in publishing generally, certainly in self-publishing, check out Joe's blog. It's called A Newbie's Guide to Publishing. Very easy to find. K-O-N-R-A-T-H is Conrad. Anyway, he wrote a blog post years ago, and I think it was called Steal My Books, because what he's found is that piracy helps sell his books. He's doing much better because of piracy. He doesn't want to stop piracy. He welcomes piracy. I know that's another subject, but I'm unusual among authors in having no problem with piracy. I don't care about piracy.
So for
actually, I do care about piracy. I like piracy.
But so for Conrath, you know, I can see if Conrath were a nonfiction author and he'd say, "Yeah, steal my book. What do I care? You're going to hire me as a consultant or a speaker." What does a novelist? How does a novelist monetize a stolen book?
You can't assume that you would have monetized the book in the absence of the theft.
Okay.
So this is again. Because I love this stuff. It really interests me. You hit the on button. It's hard to find the off switch. But the assumption in the piracy is hurting artists world is always this: that but for that pirated copy, you would have sold that copy at the full price. Now, I don't think this assumption has ever been tested, and it doesn't make logical sense to me. Someone who's willing to get something for free might not be willing to get it for $25. I don't know about that. And so I think, and I've learned a lot from Joe from this, not all my original thinking, the only way you can effectively manage piracy, I don't even use words like fight, the way to manage piracy is only through cost and convenience. In the end, you can't really manage piracy if you're going to charge $25 for your book. Piracy is going to, for a digital book. Piracy is going to beat you because most people will look at $25 free. A lot of people are going to be tempted to get the book for free. They don't even think it's stealing. Whereas if you charge, say, $3, $5, $6 for that book, and you give a great customer experience along with it, you can peel off a lot of those people who would otherwise have wanted to get the book for free. And the people who are going to insist on getting that book for free, maybe they're going to insist on it anyway. Maybe they're thrill seekers. There's nothing you can do about those people. There's always going to be shoplifting. There's always going to be some level of theft. I don't think library sales are bad. I don't think it's bad when my friends lend my books to their friends and say, "Oh my God, you got to read this. This guy's awesome." That's great by me, especially because my digital books, my self-published digital books, are far less expensive than my legacy published books. So if you discover one of my books for free, whether it's piracy or any other way, I'm pretty sure I can lure you into buying one of my books down the road because it's not that much more money. We can develop a relationship.
Okay. Shall we take some audience questions? All right. So. And we have a special reward system here, so people who ask questions get an ape T-shirt. So that way, we can encourage questions.
What about audiobooks? How are the audiobooks doing, and what do people okay. see about the future of that?
And the sizes are medium, large, extra large, so you get to. So Audible, or audio, more accurately, audiobooks.
Okay. Well, I'll start out answering that. So audiobooks for a long time, many, many years, have been a tiny industry compared to book publishing. Most books don't ever go into audio because you're going to sell one-tenth, one-twentieth the number of copies of an audiobook as you do of the print book. And so if the print book is only going to sell 5,000 copies, it's not enough on the audio to make it worthwhile. On the other hand, if the print book is selling tens of thousands or 100,000 or a million copies, then it's worthwhile. So you'll do audio. What's happened is the audio is starting to pick up some. It's becoming a little bigger share. And that's happened mainly because of digital, because now so many people are getting the listening to the audiobook on their MP3 or whatever else in other ways. So it's actually growing some, and then the new side is they've dramatically lowered the cost of audiobooks by having people basically crowdsourcing to have people record their own. The users are starting to record the audiobooks. You basically audition. People step up that they'd like to be the one that's the voice, so you're not paying professional talent anymore or paying a lot less for it. And so the audiobook field is in a period of transition, and so it's a lot of new stuff is happening.
The best thing about audio for me, I love audiobooks, but if you look at the overall dynamic, it's true for digital textbooks, also for paper books because of the espresso machine, and also for audiobooks, digital distribution is far less expensive than physical distribution. And anytime you can lower or even eliminate the cost of distribution, you can charge less for a product and make more money. If you charge less for a product, if the product has a lower cost, what happens? More people use it. That means more people reading, or in this case, listening to books on audio, which, consistent with the philosophy I mentioned at the beginning, does it cause more people to read, or does it make it harder for people to read? Digital distribution of audio makes it easier for people to listen, less expensive for people to listen to audiobooks. I think that's awesome.
Well, doesn't the Kindle app or the Kindle tablet read any book to you?
I think it's machine translation,
it's
right?
Machine, but you can.
Which is going to be a different experience.
It's not as
than,
good, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And also, just to follow up, Amazon has this big deal with Audible.
Yes. It owns Audible.
Oh, they own Audible?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
And so are they as big a gorilla in that as they are in the other parts of the publishing world?
I think so. I mean, that's my impression, that Audible is it, right?
Well, there's Brilliance too, but Amazon owns Brilliance also. So
yes.
This Audible, what Steve was mentioning, Audible has a market where you go up and you post information about your book, and then people bid on being the reader of your book. So it makes a market between authors and readers.
This is called Amazon AC, or rather Audible ACX. It's really just self-publishing for audiobooks. It's a brilliant idea.
Right. You know, I have to say, Amazon really is clever. I mean, one of the more clever things, they obviously foster Kindle self-published books, and they have an imprint called Audible Encore. Excuse me, Amazon Encore. And what Amazon Encore does is it cherry picks the best self-published books, contacts the author and says, you know, we can put the full might of Amazon behind you. Sell us the rights for your book. We'll take you to the next level. Hence, Encore, you're, you know, coming back out on stage. And that's a very clever approach. It's cherry picking. It's letting the crowd do the filtering that a traditional publisher might have done before. So,
which, of course, traditional publishers are now trying to do, too. That's the story of 50 Shades of Grey, a science fiction novel called Wool, by a guy named Hugh Howey. You should totally check it out. Wool, crazy.
Back there, yeah. Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
So what are we losing with digital publishing? I'm thinking like writing in the margins of a book, passing on, adding content to a physical book, mm-hmm. passing that along. Are we losing that, or is there something I haven't heard of yet out there that's cooking?
Well, with a Kindle, you can definitely highlight it, right? And that highlighting will go across all your devices. So you could highlight it on your Nexus 7, and it'll appear on your, you know, iPad. And also, they track when people highlight an area. They'll record, and they'll show you. And most people highlighted this area. They found this part the most interesting. But I agree, it's
but
not the same as writing in the margin.
But I think this is the important thing to understand. Anytime a new technology displaces a pre-existing technology, something is always lost and something is always gained. So, I mean, think about it. What was lost when the horse and buggy was displaced by the automobile? I think we can think of a lot of different things. What was displaced when gentlemen stopped sending each other handwritten messages because they could just make phone calls to each other? Something was lost. What was lost when the telephone stopped, at least temporarily until email, inhibited people from writing letters? A lot was lost. So many things. There's something always lost when a new system comes online. I don't think I'm Pollyannish about this. You could actually make an argument that the world was better, for example, before we had cell phones. Sometimes when I'm trapped in an elevator with someone screaming into his cell phone, I think it was a better world. But something's always lost. And we could talk about whether the world is better or whether it was worse before the new technology, but I don't know. For me, what interests me most is just asking, does the new technology have so many advantages over the existing technology that it's going to displace the existing technology? I'm more interested in predictive stuff. And then secondarily, I'm interested in, well, you know, is this overall a good thing or a bad thing for society? There's nothing I could do to change it anyway, so that's why I'm less interested in the second question. And with digital and paper, I don't think paper is going to be replaced by digital. I do think it's going to be displaced as the dominant form. Best analogy I've been able to come up with for this is candles and the electric light. If you think about it, the electric light has never replaced candlelight because there's nothing like candlelight, right? You wouldn't want to have a romantic dinner with fluorescent lights. We still use candlelight for that. But if you used to be in the lighting business, then you were also in the candlelight business. They were one and the same. When the electric light came along, the candlelight business was no longer the mass market lighting business. It became the candle business, which is not the mass market. I think that's what's happening with paper. That doesn't mean you can't make money in paper. I think a lot of money will be made in paper.
I don't see it that way. I think content will get bundled. It's not an either or. I mean, right now we've seen, I mean, if that was the case, I mean, many of our bookstores are doing thousands and thousands of 15,000 books a year and just self-published books that people want to have their physical manifestation of it. I think you're going to see more and more publishers offering. O'Reilly does it already, and they're way ahead of the curve on that. For $20, you get your ebook and you get your print book and use it as you want to. Mm-hmm. I don't.
O'Reilly's brilliant that way.
Yeah, and publishers, it will take a while for the big six to come along with that, but that's what's going to happen. You're just buying content, and it will be digitally distributed, but it will be format agnostic.
I think you could take this argument too far. You could say that at a time of when scribes were writing with quill pens on parchment, it was really just about just reading content, right? I mean, in the end, it's all content. But something better than parchment and scribes came along, and I think as good as paper is, and I'm personally a fan, as I said, the cost and convenience of digital are so much greater than paper. You will always have paper. I don't think it's going to be replaced. They use the word displaced.
In the old way that paper got distributed, you're correct.
I think what you're doing is huge in this regard.
It's really about distribution. It's not about format. It's more about distribution than
I tend to agree, but here's a quick thought experiment. Imagine this. We all grew up with digital books. There were no paper books. We all read only in digital. And today, someone says, I've got a new way of distributing books. It's going to be awesome. It's called the paper book. And that's how we're going to distribute books now. And you might say, I don't get it. Do I have to go to a bookstore? Well, yeah, or you can have it shipped to you, but I can't get it right away, right? Yeah, that's true. What if I go on vacation and I want to take 6 or 10 books? That's going to be kind of heavy, isn't it? Well, that's true. My eyes are getting weak. Can I adjust the font in these paper books? No, you can't. I don't think the world would immediately take up paper books the way it has. It wouldn't go digital to paper, I think, the way it has paper to digital, and I think there's a lesson to be learned in there. But I could be wrong about all this. The main thing for me, as I said, is that people read, not how they read.
Yeah, so what's happening right now is that the phenomenal growth of digital, where it was doubling for a couple of years, it was doubling every year, has dramatically slowed down now. And it's slowed down to double-digit growth instead of triple-digit growth. So it's pretty unclear. I mean, we're at 20% of our revenues are now coming from digital, which there's a huge split in the marketplace between fiction and nonfiction. Fiction is much, much higher, double, triple what nonfiction is in the marketplace. Leading right now is romance fiction, which sometimes is 50, 70% digital, but for nonfiction, it's well under 20%. 10 to 15% probably in the marketplace as a whole. So digital is slowing down. So I don't think the comparison is between the light and the candle. I think that if you're going to use that kind of the comparison is maybe more between television and radio, where radio is still a major means of communication, even existing alongside. I think most people in publishing The question is whether digital is going to get to 50%. Is it going to go past 50%? Right now, it's going to take a while for it to get there. Whereas a year or two ago, it was looking, well, it might be at 50% in just a year or two. And now it's looking much slower.
Okay, next question.
This is directed to Steve. Going back to your prior employer, Josie Bass, it would seem they have assets sitting there that they could partner with self-publishing authors. For example, if a self-publishing author were to come to Josie Bass and say, I know you've got lists, I know who buys what type of nonprofit book that I'm marketing to, can you help me? And can you help me at various levels? For instance, could you put out a notice on the internet to all authors who, all buyers rather, who have purchased my type of book? And then there is a fee for doing that. Or you might take a share of the royalties or whatever it is. It would seem to me that you have an asset sitting there not working with that I think you could monetize.
Okay, well, let me first say that I know a great deal about Josie Bass. I founded the Josie Bass Business and Management Series. I was involved when I was president to help start the Josie Bass Nonprofit Series that you're referring to now. So I know a lot about their list, and there's an overlap between what Josie Bass does and what Berrett-Koehler does. What you're really asking is should publishers change what business they're in, whether they're in a business of offering advice to authors or they're in a business of providing, renting out their mailing list or selling space in their newsletters and in their places that reach out to their markets. It's a different business, and I think whether publishers are going to get into that kind of business is a big question. Now, what is happening, which relates to what we've been talking about, is that many of the publishers have now set up self-publishing imprints, including Berrett-Koehler. We have a self-publishing partnership called Open Book Editions that is done through iUniverse with Author Solutions, the same Author Solutions that was just purchased by Penguin and that has self-publishing partnerships with a bunch of other publishers. And so we're playing that self-publishing market also. We don't get nearly as much money from the self-publishing partnership as we do from books that we publish ourselves. It's a tiny fraction, but it provides some other benefits. It broadens our community. It brings more people into our community. It provides kind of a farm system where we are testing out books that we're not sure are going to work. And if we see that they're working through the self-publishing part, then we may pick them up on our regular list. We just did that with a book that we're publishing through our regular imprints. And so this is a time of experimentation. So publishers are trying things along the lines of what you're talking about, although not specifically what you just suggested so much.
Okay, next question.
Right here. So I'm going to ask a first question that touches on something that you brought up before, which is sponsorships. Or you brought it up loosely in the case of conferences and distributing material. My first touch into publishing was being approached by McGraw-Hill and John Wiley when I was an analyst and written a big report that they wanted to turn into a book. And my firm had no idea what to do with it because Wall Street firms aren't in the business of selling books. In any case, I had to get an education real quick, but I did discover that sponsorships can be very lucrative, and especially for business authors and people who may do a lot of speaking engagements like Guy, to go out and sell an experience and then to go out and sell a book that could be useful or have useful content for workers could be a great model. So how do you think that changes in publishing right now might impact that, number one? And number two, I wanted to ask each of you, looking ahead, what would you like to see in self-publishing or in publishing right now that's missing? What element? You've all touched on things that you know, trends that you see right now, but what would you like to see that you think is a missing piece?
So let me talk about the sponsorship thing, because I did one of those. I wrote a book called What the Plus, and it explains Google Plus. And I sold the sponsorship to the book to Samsung. And so I enabled Samsung to give away 6,000 copies of What the Plus. And the way I did it was I used actually You Send It. And You Send It, you can set the number of downloads that are possible before it expires or the time. So I just set the number, and actually they bought 6,000, but I set it to 8,000 because I got the Eisler theory of piracy. So,
as it shall be known.
Right. So 8,000 people downloaded it. Samsung was happy. When people opened the ebook, the first page was an ad for the Samsung Note, and if you clicked on it, you went to the Samsung website. So they sponsored the book, and it was a beautiful experience because for me, whether I allowed them to download 6,000 or 8,000 copies, there's no difference. I mean, in price. I mean, it's arguably that was pure profit, right? And so that was a beautiful thing for me. It was good for them. And I would do it again all day long. And this is one of the reasons why I self-publish books now, because if I called up Penguin and I said, Penguin, you know, this is what I want to do. Samsung wants to be able to download 6,000 copies of this book. They would have an aneurysm. They would just, they could not handle that transaction. So sponsorship is a very viable way, I think. You had a second question. What's missing? Okay.
I can answer that one really quickly just from the author's perspective. A better set of self-publishing tools. A lot of people are talking about this, and a lot of people are trying to solve this problem. Clay Shirky said, publishing now is a button, which arguably is a little bit of an exaggeration, but mostly it's true, and there's a lot to consider in that statement. But the problem is getting to the point where you can press that button and self-publish your book, getting it formatted correctly for upload, for digital distribution, is sufficiently complex so that I've got a guy who does it for me, who's great.
It's one-third of Ape, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. And actually, Ape is terrific on this if you're a do-it-yourself type, which I'm not that technologically savvy, and I've got a guy who's awesome at this, so he does it for me. But it would certainly be a boon to readers and self-published authors if there were a simple set of tools, and so far there's really not. A guy named Mark Coker is trying to solve this problem at Smashwords, a place called Smashwords. He's got something he sometimes calls, I think it's still called the meat grinder, where you can, if your Word document is formatted correctly, you can upload it into the meat grinder, and the meat grinder will turn it into an EPUB file and a MOBI file, EPUB for Barnes & Noble, MOBI for Amazon. But even getting the Word document formatted correctly for Smashwords guidelines, I understand, is a bit of a pain in the neck.
I think
publishing tools.
As I read someplace that the guideline for Smashwords, the upload instructions for doing that,
yeah,
is 25,000 words.
Yeah.
So it's a 25,000 word document to figure out how to upload Word to make it meat grinder ready.
Not a good sign.
Yeah, not a good sign. Not a good sign, yeah. So any...
I would add that people who are considering self-publishing, they need to learn a lot more. And you can do that in many ways. One of them is joining the Publishers Marketing Association, where you will get an education. They do conferences where you can go and learn all the ins and outs and talk to other people who are doing this. There are a bunch of marketing workshops around. It's easier to produce your self-published book than it is to actually sell it. And just having it available on Amazon or having it available in other places doesn't mean you're going to sell more than a small number of copies.
Of course, that's true for the legacy world, too.
Right. Well, it's even more true on the self-publishing, but either way. And so in our case, our authors cooperative sponsors an annual marketing workshop for authors, and self-published authors can sign up for it also. They can go to it as well. But you need to learn the ropes of what it's really going to take in order to make a proposition out, unless you just want to fill up your garage with books or just want to give it out to your family. And you know, if you have bigger ambitions than that.
How many people here are thinking about self-publishing a book, can I ask? Or have self-published a book, yeah. Mm-hmm. Good for you.
Any other?
Well, I don't know if I'm qualified to even answer that, but I think that the what's missing, I'd more answer in terms of what I wish would happen more. And I think that I wish the multinationals would get out of publishing and sort of declare it a success and move on. I mean, it is so corrupted the quality of real publishers and the decision making when they're just a part of a larger entity to sell toys and all the other knickknacks and crap that come through the sort of chain of publish a book, make a movie, make a toy, sell it at McDonald's. And I think that we all really don't benefit from that model. And so I just hope and wish that whatever does come from digital and the rest, that publishers start to get it better, do a better job of what their skills are and could somehow just get smaller in the process. The legacy publishers, you described them, are clueless right now as to what to do.
You're not going to stock the Guy Kawasaki bobblehead doll in Kepler.
I'll put in a word for you.
Dane, what your...
I think just generally the biggest threat to books is the lack of literacy, really. I mean, that's just a cultural comment. I think that we do have a problem in the United States, and people are reading less and less and distracted with things that are... with video games and the like. So I think, on the other hand, when you go outside of America and you go to Europe, you go to Africa and China, literacy is going up to some extent. But I think in our country, if I had a wish list, it was just, encouraging children to read more. Gosh, if they would steal more books, terrific. That means they want to read.
That's true. Next question.
Hey, so Steve had mentioned, right, that the number of books being published is going up, and but the sales are stagnating, right? And so I'm just taking his comment, but this comment actually really is for you, Barry. Don't you think that I'm thinking, to me it seems like that part of that might be not just about people having the time, but when you present people with more choices. And it may just be because they're less expensive or whatever, right? That people end up not buying anything. I see that with me.
Yes.
Because now I can so easily buy this, that, so, translating, you're saying you're all for this because you think, bringing down prices or, direct, that it's going to offer people more choice. But
yes.
I don't think more choice necessarily translates to more reading.
In some contexts, it might not. I remember reading about this in one of Malcolm Gladwell's books where I think it was Smuckers or some jelly company.
They did it at Drager's.
Yeah, was it spaghetti sauce or jelly or something?
It was jellies, flavors of jelly.
They found if you give people, you would think, hey, this way, if we give you 20 different kinds of jelly, then we'll have just the jelly for you and more people will buy it. But actually, there's something in psychology such that people see 20 jellies and they just say, that's too much. I can't even make a buying decision. Mm-hmm. So there's some optimum range of choice. But on the other hand, you don't want to give them just one kind of jelly because maybe it's not the one they want. So there's some, it's a Goldilocks principle, I guess you could say. But in the book world, what you just articulated is a version of what I sometimes call with my friend Joe Conrad, the tsunami of crap argument. And the tsunami of crap, it's a version, it's not right on, but it's similar. Go look. Once we've taken away the gatekeepers, the nurturing curators of literary content, then the floodgates will open and anyone who thinks he or she can write a book will in fact write and publish a book, and what we will have is a tsunami of crap that will overwhelm Western civilization. That's happening right now as we speak. And if this were true, there are a lot of ways of addressing this argument, but it's been my observation that in any area where content becomes too much for a consumer to meaningfully sample it herself, third-party systems kick in to help us all manage all that extra content. There are a lot of examples of this. Movies, books, travel.
Yelp.
Yelp, and actually Yelp is different ways of doing it within different industries, but even within, for example, music is another one, television, when I was a little kid, there were only a few channels, maybe 10 or not even 7 channels or something. You could sample all the channels yourself. Satellite television, no. So there are different ways of doing it. Maybe TV Guide, I don't know, I don't really watch that much TV, maybe that's an antiquated example. But with books, here's the thing, there have always been too many books for any of us to sample ourselves, right? So we have systems that help winnow what's available to a meaningful amount of choice within which we can make a decision that's good for ourselves. We've had publishers, we've had bookstores. Still, you walk into a Barnes & Noble superstore, even a smaller store. Kepler's is a big independent, but walk into a small independent. There's far too many books, and you can't possibly sample it yourself. So then we have independent booksellers, hand selling, word of mouth, reviews, a lot of different ways. The thing to remember across the board in any technological revolution, and certainly in this one, I think, is this. Don't conflate the way things have always been done before with the way with all the different ways they can be done. Don't conflate the entity that has been performing a function with the function itself, because we definitely need winnowing in the world of books. We always have. There are too many books for any of us to meaningfully sample for ourselves. But to think that what follows from that is that only legacy publishers can perform that winnowing function, or only brick and mortar independent booksellers, I don't think that makes any sense. There are a lot of different ways of winnowing choice, and it's being done right now. Last example, I just have to give it to you. If it were true that a tsunami of crap would prohibit people from making meaningful use of a system, the internet could not exist. The internet is 99.9999999% crap. I have not done a scientific study, but I'm pretty sure this is true. And yet...
It's not that low.
And yet, we're all able to make meaningful use of the internet. So somehow, even in the face of the vastness of the internet crap, we're able to make use of it. And I'm sure this is going to be the case in the book world.
Well, I don't know if it's true. Someone told me this. In China, you have to have a license to be a publisher, even a self-publisher. So, you know, that's the flip side. Would you prefer that system? I mean, can you imagine going to Mitt Romney and saying, can I publish this book? Oh, my God. Jesus. Legitimate rape, yeah. I got to ask you one more question. We're going to take one last question, all right? So, Clark, I know that when I go to Cafe Baroni now, and I sign into the wireless network, it's Facebook, right? So you have some kind of partnership with Facebook that Facebook is providing the wireless. And so for me to get free wireless sitting in Baroni, I have to check in. I have to have liked the Kepler's page. And now I have to check in. So now every one of my subscribers on Facebook knows that I'm at Baroni and I've checked in to get wireless. So is that working well? I mean, I love it, I must say.
I think it is. It's new. And not something that we'd been doing previously, but capturing the audience that sits out there at that cafe and letting them know there's things going on inside the bookstore has been an objective that we've had for some time, and I'm hearing about this for the first time that Kepler's is doing this. So,
oh yeah, well I salute you. It's very clever.
Yeah.
So okay, one last question. Next question or last question? It's Dan Gilmore.
Okay, in Barry, by the way, there's tons of data about replacement and that. Two quick questions for everybody. One is DRM going to die in books, or is it going to continue? And the other one is, before digital, I knew what a book was. In the digital world, what is a book?
Too deep for me to handle. You guys handle
this. In terms of what is
it? I'm asking
what is
because there's
what's it becoming?
There, so yeah. Many media forms are being combined
and
into what people are calling books. Yeah. I'm just wondering what would be a one sentence description of what a book is when we move into this future.
We in book publishing talk a lot now about content rather than about the format. But I would say that a book is an idea or content that is too much or too big to put into just a blog posting or to put into an article. It's something that has a bigger message, more to it, that people will pay for. So far, we in book publishing have been fortunate. We haven't gone the way of the newspaper industry in the sense of everyone expecting everything to be free. There still are, one way of looking at it is a book is a sufficient amount of content, help, ideas, entertainment, something that people are willing to pay for it as an individual entity. That's one answer. I mean, there are probably different ways of answering that question.
Well, I think that's excellent. I would add that I hope that book also means for many of them that are timeless, that so much of the information that we get through the internet and other sources is data in, data out, and we move on, and it's dead the next year. Books are, the best books are experiences that translate over generations and are timeless. And I hope that books going forward maybe are a way to define that as a different from the noise of information that we get through all the other media.
Your second question.
Is DRM going to die?
DRM going to die. Is that a question or are we supposed to vote? I'm sorry?
I certainly hope so, but it's not my question for them is, you know, as publishers and others, is DRM going to be, are we stuck with it?
I hope DRM dies. I think that DRM, you can't stop the people who are going to steal from you, and it inconveniences the people who would not steal from you.
In case anybody doesn't know, this is called digital rights management. This is a way of preventing people from illicitly copying content.
So I hope it dies. My Ape is a Kindle book, and so there's a baseline of DRM that just is there. But you can also check a box and put more DRM on it. We have not checked the box.
We don't use DRM. It's only PDFs. But the book never goes to the consumer. It goes right. It goes to the machine and is deleted.
Yeah. David, do you want to respond to that?
I was just going to say, in a nonfiction world,
microphone.
We see books as lifelong learning, and so what we see happening is that the books will start embedding video, audio, animation, games, simulations, lots of different online learning, and communication with communities. And so over time, the digital book, especially for nonfiction, will evolve to something that's much more of a active learning type of an instrument versus a passive learning. And so what you know of books today, where you're just having communication with words, will evolve to be something much more learning-oriented and active, where you are participating with other people. And the neat thing about that is you've always been able to do that with seminars and workshops in live environments, but now to do that virtually, where your live environment is a virtual community across the world, 7 billion people, it really extends the notion of what is a book beyond what anyone's thinking of today. So we don't see that right away today. You see just the enhanced e-books and self-assessments and mobile apps starting, but take that 10 years from now in the nonfiction world for people graduating from college and then doing their own lifelong learning, self-directed, between 20 and 80, that'll be huge. So that's where we're doing a lot of investing.
Okay. So we are out of time, right, Karen? You're like signaling frantically, yes. So they got a bar mitzvah coming in here soon. So,
Thank you very much,
Barbara, and thank Citrix for hosting us. It's a
thank
great place.
Guy, Steve, Dane, Clark, Barry. And thank all of you. Thank you so much. You've been a wonderful audience. Thank you, and see you next year. Happy holidays.